To continue examining the essence of the secular society and as an example correlations between morality and policy in a secularized world. I said earlier that the spiritual and ethical potential of traditional values, which embodied first of all in world religions, is not wasted yet. Moreover, mankind can survive only on the basis of these common and human values, because humanity doesn't have other absolute values. And they are the same, because they have transcendent source that were opened to humanity in the axial age. And a person and a nation can't live without ones. This is an idea spoken out by Dostoevsky, who is a profound philosopher, I think, who uttered his ideas in a literature form. Also, Russian religion philosophy of the first third of the 20th century, who was killed in 1977 in a concentration camp, Pavel Florensky. Pavel Florensky wrote that culture can't exist without absolute ideal. Each culture has in its background this absolute ideal. Faith is attitude to this absolute ideal, and this faith creates culture. Culture is a consequence from the faith to this ideal. And a human person lives inside culture and is built by it. German psychotherapist Carl Gustav Jung also proclaimed an idea of archetype that lies in the background of any culture. Philosophically, we may say that the culture exists only on the basis of spiritual archetype, each culture. For example, Confucianism and Taoism are such archetypes for Chinese culture, no Marxist ideas. It's only a little episode, but and now we see that Chinese try to return to this spiritual background, yeah. Because they don't have future on Marxist ideas and so on. For India, for example, we can mention such archetype as the conception of Brahman Atman, and for Europe, it is a face to Christ resurrection. That's why Dostoevsky said that if sometimes the science will prove that resurrection hadn't been, he continued believe to resurrection, but not to scientific discovery. Was he so dull, or was he so ignorant? No, he clearly understood that faith to resurrection created European culture. It is faith that goodness and eternity overcome evil and death. And only inside this, created by faith, European culture could appear science. Science is only an instrument, but not an essence or aim. And science can't by itself lead people to surviving from animal existence. It can do only humanity and compassion, which come from virtue, transcendent ideal, faith to it. What is secularization? Secularization, from this point of view, is replacing of the main values based on this faith, to virtue, transcendent, absolute, to something other, that is not transcendental and is not virtue. Faith was distorted to believing to any kind of idolatry or superstitions. Society is returning to pagan barbarism. That is, I think, is secularity. It destroys morality and all civilized norms on which were based relations between genders, was based family, etc. All these also lead to catastrophic situation in social-political relations. They are deprived of their moral dimension. Historically, and in ideas, it began from the time of Renaissance. In political philosophy, from creativity of Niccolò Machiavelli. Last time in Constanza, I spoke about Machiavelli's position and its difference from Machiavellianism. But in general, we can speak about four variants of correlations between morality and policy. Let's examine them. So, four thesis of correlations, logically, we can mention. First thesis. It is a teaching of Niccolò Machiavelli, so-called Machiavellistva. And his thesis is, a good political end justifies all the means. And we discussed already this statement. The second, this is Machiavellian. The end justifies any means. And this is not policy at all, I think. It is criminal activity. And this is the policy of Hitler, Stalin, Bolsheviks, and so on. The second statement is humanistic policy. Its statement is the good end can be achieved only by good means. The good end can be achieved only by good means. No resistance to evil by violence, but the resistance to evil by force. And the fourth variant is pacific. Non-resistant to evil by force. It proclaimed, for example, Leo Tolstoy in Russia. Position of Machiavelli, the essence of this position is in the following. He put morality inside policy. So, a politician can use morality in his own aims, but morality became a tool in the hands of politicians. So morality destroys its general dimension. So it's not morality at all. It's skilled in this situation. Because morality has a general level. Policy must be included into morality, but not morality into policy. Machiavellism also destroyed all morality. And because its aim has nothing to do with moral ideas. In real, a power cannot be regarded as the end in itself. Power is only an instrument used to pursue a particular political purpose. Aristotle defined politics as tending towards the good. He wrote, if the ultimate goal of all sciences and arts is good, then the supreme good should be the predominant purpose of the most important of all arts and sciences, namely politics. The state good is fairness. That is what serves the common good. So, from Aristotle's point of view, policy can be only moral policy and no other policy. Let's examine humanistic politics more carefully. In new times, it was elaborated and introduced into the practice by Immanuel Kant, Fyodor Dostoevsky, Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, etc. It is based on the thesis, as it was mentioned above, good ends can be achieved only with good means. This statement is not only abstract or wish of a cartoon character, quote Leopold said in a Russian cartoon, let's live peacefully. But nobody wants to live peacefully, yes? But this is not only abstract wish. It is an axiom proven by practice, for example, in Mahatma Gandhi's activity and Martin Luther King. The point is that the ends depend on the means they are achieved by. This is why good ends cannot be achieved through bad means. Otherwise, they will mutate and become different, not good ones. Answering the question, what is the true policy? Ivan Ilyin, Russian philosopher, writes, adopting organic solidarity of everyone, with everyone. And then we can speak about activity of Mahatma Gandhi. He may serve as a model of humanistic policy of non-violent resistance. And Mahatma Gandhi, his worldview based on traditional values of Hindu metaphysics, Jainism metaphysics. So he had metaphysical background of his activity. He succeeded to make a seemingly impossible thing, practically proving the possibility of non-violence politics and one when violence was a widespread and accepted norm, perceived as something like death. Before him, violence in political affairs was considered to be as natural and necessary as the biological death of a man of old age. Since Gandhi's actions were based on spiritual generating morality, his behavior was unpredictable. His sincerity and sacrifice disarmed his opponents. For example, when accused to demise of the victims incurred as a result of Satyagraha, he refused to defend himself, admitting his guilt for the bloodshed. In America, the famous follower of Mahatma Gandhi was Martin Luther King. And he, as you know, struggled against segregation and racism. Also, four variants of mentioned correlation we can explain through some scheme I'd like to show it, to explain it. First of all, we have metaphysical ideal, faith. And down we have real life. And real life is not ideal. And between this moral ideal and practical life, we have put conscience. And conscience is a tie between this moral ideal and real life. Moral ideal that is on metaphysical level ought to be correlated with the real political life. And this correlation has to be harmonic. It is reached through the conscience, which must correlate here and now the dirtiness of existing with purity of the metaphysical ideal. In case it is accomplished, we received humanistic policy. If not, we get other non-humanistic results. In case when the moral ideal suppress the real life, we get Kantianism and Tolstovstvo, teaching of Leo Tolstoy. Immoral pacifism. When existing dirtiness of the life suppress and even reject the ideal, we get Machiavellstvo or even Machiavellianism. Immanuel Kant, not in his ethics, but in his history of philosophy, developed a series of realistic suggestions by which mankind can eliminate wars. No, for example, no regular army, refusal to finance warfare, non-interference with internal affairs, etc. His suggestions can be put into practice, yet reality lacks its single aspect, political will, on the one hand, and the requirements of universal civil society, on the other hand, which could force politicians to actively address the issue of ending violence in the world. Some of these items are implemented. Partly they are breached, and some have not accepted yet. For example, refusal to finance arms production and keeping standing armies, elimination of the arms race, etc. Yet, along with that, Enlightenment utopianism is typical of Kant too. He believes that the public will get enlightened by itself if given freedom. Dostoevsky supposes that God and the devil are struggling in the heart of man to gain his soul. He regards human nature as antinomic. According to him, reason cannot combat evil alone. Moreover, reason itself can't save it. Unlike Kant, who became the founder of German classical political philosophy, Dostoevsky may be referred to as the founder of existential humanist political philosophy. He has developed his ideas, especially deeply in The Brothers Karamazov, The Idiot and The Devils, where he provides unmatched criticism of revolutionary violence. According to Dostoevsky, compassion is the main and perhaps the only law of existence for the entire mankind. It is reflected through all his writings. The most profound, significant and radical is the symbol of the so-called single tear shed by a child, described by Dostoevsky in The Rebellion of Ivan Karamazov. When the character refuses to accept a bright future, perfect society, if creating its foundation requires at least one tear of the child. And he wrote, and if the sufferings of children go to swell the sum of sufferings which was necessary to pay for truth, then I protest that the truth is not worth such a price. Dostoevsky agrees with Kant that the person is an end in itself and can never serve as a means. So we have to strive to existential, personal philosophy of a history and reject Machiavellian and Hegel Marxist's philosophy of history and historical determinism. Because in history there is no any determinism. There is only moral actions, and moral actions of a person produce real progress. If there is no moral actions, no historical laws produce any progress. Thank you.
So how do you respond to my question that I introduced you with, the Protean man versus the moral man of Dostoevsky? I mean, how do you see this dichotomy?
I don't hear, please, sorry.
The Professor Julian was talking about the Protean man, the postmodern, who goes from one situation to another, and in each situation there is an ethic that he follows, as opposed to having a unified moral vision that he takes with him that binds up his life. You presented us with a vision of a perennial wisdom coming out of the axial age that is shared, that's deep, that's truly human, that the religions of the world all acknowledge. And so I'm asking you to tell us how that contrasts with the postmodern vision.
Oh, yeah. It's absolutely different, because postmodernism killed the truth. It says that no universal truth. Each person has its own truth. So Dostoevsky said that if there is no God, everything is permitted. You know, and what is God? God is the universal truth. And if we believe to this universal truth, we can't have morality. Because morality, this is a thing that unites all of us. And if we kill this, we can't even create community. It will be war, one against another. So postmodernism situation, it's a catastrophic situation. If people believe that there is no truth, universal truth, the civilization and the society will come to an end. And now postmodernism, it is like intellectual game, you know, of some intellectuals. But when it will come to real life, it will be catastrophic, I think.
Right, so would you say that the postmodern is premised on a set of these perennial values, that these are its capital, that it's spending, and it can play these games about personal narrative and all of this, but it's living on this prior social capital, this prior moral, spiritual capital that comes from these traditional values?
I think that on the base of this philosophy, we can't combine. It's like syncretism, but not synthesis. Because we can combine, for example, I try to do it, but on the basis of the concept of Excel age, that has mutual base, but we can't combine in other way, just only to summarize different ideas. They won't work.
To fast forward a little bit, I mean, as Bill Saunders pointed out in many respects, postmodernism is kind of a reaction to the horrors of the Great Wars. The idea that how can there be a grand narrative when humans are so capable of violence? Should God not have stepped in to prevent this? So some people throw up their hands and said, "Oh, I guess there isn't a God if he didn't take it upon himself to prevent this kind of butchery and massacre from happening." But that reactionary momentum and fervor is, to a certain extent, dying down. What we're seeing instead is this battle concerning the origin of morality, with some people who are still spiritual and religious saying the origin of morality will always be rooted in the divine sphere. That allows us to always look forward to higher heights, if you want, of moral behavior. And then you have now the opposing ideology, which kind of comes from evolutionary psychology, which I'm not a big fan of, but nonetheless has its merits, that are saying that morality is stemmed to a certain extent in our very biology, that if we are to be social animals, we can't go around killing people and stealing from everybody. So we have new narratives that are futurist in nature, saying tolerance is the way to create this perfect society, which of course has its own attendant dangers and missteps. But there is a new battle of narratives that has taken place. You know, the battle that characterized postmodernity to a certain extent has ended. People are beginning to realize that they can't live in an absence of some type of moral narrative that comes from somewhere. So now they're saying, let's replace God with human nature, a revival, if you want, a neo-humanism. But can that truly replace divine morality? I mean, I would agree and say obviously not. I mean, we're all around here at this table pretty much saying no, it's impossible. But there are people who are steadfastly and quite fervently of the opinion that humans are entirely capable of creating their own universal morality. So those are the rules or the parameters of a very new contention that we have to be aware of.
I don't know what is new there. For example, if you remember ethnic antique philosophy sophists, you know, for me it's like this, it's nothing new. And if we study history of Christianity, we can find some heresy, you know, such concept of Gnosticism was at the area of Christianity, and we can find some ideas, some of these ideas. It's, uh, I I don't see nothing new in for future. For future, I see the destruction of what was, because maybe it is a special reaction on some things that was also in church and so on, but it's not protective, productive for future. Yes, we have to assimilate heritage, spiritual heritage of all religions to the present day, yes, and in art manner, yes, not in dull dogmatic, but we have to improve it to the present day, but not to refuse from them, I think.
How do we translate the theological language into a public language? I mean, if the language is, you can call it philosophical, or, but it's philosophical in this deeper sense, it's really not different from what I call theological, right? I mean, this perennial tradition you're talking about. So does that have to be translated into public, into a public language for public discourse?
It's the problem of education. I think that now education, for example, in Russia, it is destructive education. It not teach, but I don't know what will new generations have in their minds, you know, because this we don't teach pupil to moral ideal, no moral ideal at all in so-called secularized education, and a person without moral ideal is like a ship without rule. And so first of all, we have to create true educational system, but I don't see in present society even wish for this. Its process is very bad, you know, we destroyed what was before, maybe it was not always good, but don't create something positive new.
We have this experience. We teach religion as discipline in the all level of schools, from primary to high school, and thing didn't change in good, only in worse, for example, for 20 years, you know? So maybe the whole system, as you said, should be changed. But I'd like to point out, to point to the, what you are saying about the manipulation of the morality or the moral by the politics. You know, I don't know if you are familiar with the elections from the Republic of Moldavia. Between what they were very recently this year, I guess, or in 2016. There were two candidates. One of them, Igor Dodon. To say pro-Russian candidate. The second one was Maia Sandu, a pro-European candidate. The campaign of Igor Dodon was, I'm not politically affiliated, so it's not, I'm not the subject. The message of Igor Dodon was that Maia Sandu wants to bring into the Republic of Moldavia homosexuality, abortion, divorce, especially because she's not married. She is about 40, something like that, you know. And all those bad things that can, that come from Europe, from the West, are against our Christian
national tradition,
so on, and we are true Christians and we like to keep it. Of course, Igor Dodon won the election. The paradox is that Igor Dodon is communist. He's atheist by officially and by personal religion and so on. Maia Sandu is part of the right wing party. And she's for the traditional values in the society. But like that, you can manipulate moral. You know, and now, of course, the Republic of Moldavia is the same, and there are LGBT manifestations in the streets and so on. So it's but it's a matter of manipulation, you know? Via morality.
I think that if we have had educated citizens, they should know how to vote. But we don't have them anymore. We don't educate our voters in order to not be manipulated.
Well, I'm not saying that they voted wrong or good. It's a matter of how this message was used. And of course, church was very sensitive from the Republican one. It was very sensitive at this message, you know? So...
But it's this situation in Moldova is not so bad, for example, as is France in the USA and so on. We saw the elections in these countries and it's impossible. It's called democracy, but it deals nothing with real democracy. So it's everywhere. This is the problem because the political sphere loses morality. We have to return morality to it. Sphere. Without it, nothing impossible, and no any progress, and so on. So now, so-called democracy is not true democracy, but a manipulation of persons, of citizens.
But then, who is to be the final arbiter of that world?
Yes,
I mean,
yes.
It would be wonderful if God Himself came down and said, "Yo, this is how it works." But we still rely on human interpretation. When you vest authority in a particular human source, you invite all manner of dangers. People want consensus, but they haven't found a way to get along. People are ignorant, so they are easily manipulated. If we educated everyone, that would be great, because then everyone could make informed decisions. But then how do you educate them? What syllabus do you use? What curriculum do you use? How do you accommodate for the fact that everyone learns differently and expresses that knowledge differently?
Yes, we can't do everything, but I think we, teachers, intellectuals, scientists, we have first what we have to do, to proclaim true ideas and to say what is wrong and to say what is evil and what is good, you know? Because now in this sphere, I saw a lot of journalists, politicians, and lawyers. They stand on the side of evil, you know. They proclaim not truth, but false and so on. Stop it, first of all, in our sphere, yes, and then try to press politicians and public opinion to correct view, to true view. This is struggle, and we have to launch it. Without it, nothing will be.
Yeah. May I add something to this question you have raised first, the philosophical approach and the theological approach, you know, converge in some areas, but I think Sergei is right, we have to defend the principles, but instead what we are doing, I mean, in theologically, it's like a secular morality is like an advance payment, and the religious morality is a deferred payment, okay? So people are going that way. So also the secularists are using moral arguments to deceive people by showing immediate danger, and we are saying them, you know, the some possible danger. You see, that's how it played out probably in that election. And so that is the question, I guess, we have to deal with here.
I think that everybody speaks about these moral principles. Everybody teaches them in an intellectual way. We teach the intellect and theoretical knowledge, but we never teach the will,
yes,
in a way. I mean, nobody knows. We know how these principles work, but we do not know how to apply them in different contexts.
How that will is effective.
And I think that this kind of practical applications should be done in school.
Yeah.
We should also try to teach the will, how
to
act,
the will, yeah.
how to apply a certain moral principle in different contexts of actions.
Yeah.
And I think that us in Romania, we don't do that. We only offer intellectual knowledge.
Right, and religion does that too when it becomes moralistic and dogmatic. Yes.
Exactly.
As opposed to ascetical and practical and functioning, mm-hmm. form character and following the ascetical way and witnessing.
You know, it's interesting. In Soviet times, Solzhenitsyn, great writer, yeah, you know, he wrote to Russian intelligentsia, Soviet intelligentsia, in the 60s and 70s, he wrote, "Stop, tell a lie. Just stop telling a lie. You are not be killed if you don't speak lie. Stop it. If you can't say truth, don't speak at all. But when you speak to students in public sphere, don't speak lie, a lie. You know, I think that we have intellectuals to start from this, not to speak lie, not to support lie, because now in mass media, absolute lie, you know, absolute lie. And it is impossible sometimes to find the true information, you know. And this lie produces hostility, you know, hostility between nations, states, and so on. So we have to stop this process, because it leads to new wars, you know. And it produces mass media. And you know, in the Bible it is, who is the devil? The devil is a father of lie. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. So we stop to serve the devil, mm-hmm. You know.
On that note, I want to thank you, Professor Sergei, for a fine presentation.